Thanks to Dashlane for sponsoring this video. When wading through the river of health advice, where you can find people saying one thing is good and other people saying the exact opposite is good, it's helpful to have a couple strategies for logically vetting information. Some lines of logic are better than others.
Not a bear in sight. The bear patrol must be working like a charm.
That's specious reasoning, Dad. By your logic, I could claim that this rock keeps tigers away.
Oh, how does it work?
It's just a stupid rock.
Uh-huh.
But I don't see any tigers around here, do you?
Lisa, I want to buy your rock.
I want to share with you four things to consider when analyzing health-related information. The history, the context, the mechanisms, and the short-term versus the long-term. As we go through each of these, we'll look at examples of how this can apply to evaluating diets or medications, but throughout the video, I'll look in particular at antidepressants. I should say at this point that this, of course, is not intended to be medical advice, and if you happen to be on an antidepressant, whatever you do, don't abruptly stop taking it without consulting a professional. Let's start with history. For diet, this usually means looking at the diet from an evolutionary perspective. For example, if I were looking at the fruitarian diet, I would be critical of the fact that it's very unlikely that we were eating primarily fruit in prehistoric times, considering our guts shrank as our brain got bigger. But even if we were eating fruit, the fruit we would have gotten back then wouldn't have been much at all like the modern-day fruit that through domestication and cultivation has come to be much bigger and much sweeter. As Daniel Lieberman points out in his book, The Story of the Human Body, almost all the fruits our ancestors did eat were about as sweet as carrots. That means a prehistoric fruitarian diet would be a lot more like a modern-day vegetable diet. Moving on, when looking at medicines or prescription drugs, we'd want to know the history. What was the logic that led to the development and application of that drug? Let's compare the history of insulin to the history of antidepressants. The history behind insulin, very briefly, goes like this. A disease called type 1 diabetes was discovered that was causing children to waste away and die within months. German scientists suspected the pancreas was at fault for diabetes in 1889, and Eugene Opie, in 1901, very accurately suspected that a lack of internal secretion, specifically from the islet of Langerhans in the pancreas, was the major problem. Scientists made several attempts at turning the pancreas into a medicine, feeding patients raw pancreas and giving them ground-up extracts of the pancreas, with not so great results. Finally, in January 1922, after many discouraging failed experiments, David Banting and Charles Best, with the vital help of James B. Collip, successfully treated a boy's diabetes with a pancreatic extract. This marked the discovery of insulin and was a historical moment for medicine. So in the case of insulin, the cause of a disease was first well theorized based on very careful observations, and then a medicine was created based on the assumed pathology of the disease. Okay, so what about antidepressants? The order of events is very different. In 1955, Bernard Brody and Arvid Carlson found that an herbal drug called reserpine seemed to make animals lethargic, apathetic, and depressed. This mood-depressing drug also reduced brain levels of norepinephrine, dopamine, and serotonin. These three are all technically monoamines, but norepinephrine and dopamine are classified as catecholamines. Then it was found that the drugs iproniazid and imipramine could prevent the lethargy and apathy if given before the depressing drug reserpine. Iproniazid and imipramine seemed to have an antidepressant effect. These two so-called antidepressants block the usual depletion of the catecholamines dopamine and norepinephrine and block the depletion of the monoamine serotonin. You may be familiar with the famous chemical imbalance theory of depression and other mental disorders. Joseph Schildkraut deserves some credit for this. In 1965, he said that some, if not all, depressions are associated with an absolute or relative deficiency of catecholamines, particularly norepinephrine. After that, researchers quickly turned much of their attention to serotonin, guessing a deficiency in serotonin to be the root cause of depression. So in this case, researchers first understood how a drug worked, then assumed the cause of depression based on the way that drug works. So what's the problem with this? The American Psychiatric Association's own 1999 textbook explains that assuming depression is caused by low serotonin because a drug that seemed to prevent depression raises serotonin, is similar to concluding that because aspirin causes gastrointestinal bleeding, headaches are caused by too much blood loss, and the therapeutic action of aspirin in headaches involves blood loss. So in 1999, the APA is making fun of how the chemical imbalance idea came to be. The next point is about context, which is especially important to consider. For example, in the context of a low-carbohydrate diet, plenty of good quality butter could be perfectly healthy and not make you gain weight. But if you're consuming lots of butter in the context of a high-carbohydrate diet, the insulin effect of the carbohydrate is going to have you store more of the butter you eat as body fat. And eating a lot of carbs by themselves is very different from eating a lot of carbs when they're wrapped in fiber, in the form of vegetables. There are many other contexts to look at, but an obvious one is genes. Certain populations can be more susceptible to certain diseases, and certain gene polymorphisms can affect your levels of certain vitamins like folate, vitamin B6 and B12, beta-carotene, and vitamin D. It would be very interesting to see the differences in genetics or maybe microbiome status of Rich Roll and Michaela Peterson. Rich Roll is an ultra-endurance athlete. In 2010, he completed 5 Ironman distance triathlons in under a week. Part of his fame comes from the fact that he manages these impressive feats of endurance while maintaining a vegan diet, a diet that for him was a key component to his athletic success. At age 40, Rich found himself winded from just climbing a flight of stairs. This was the trigger to get him to switch to a plant-only diet. 2 years later, and 50 pounds lighter, he became the first vegan to complete the 320-mile Super Endurance Ultraman event, finishing in the top 10 males. On the other hand, we have Michaela Peterson, who, since at least as early as the age of 7, had severe rheumatoid arthritis, began taking antidepressants for severe anxiety and depression from around age 11, had many joints replaced by age 17 thanks to the arthritis, and had severe skin problems from age 19. At one point, she was sleeping 17 hours a day and had to rely on Adderall just to keep herself awake, not to mention taking 2 different antidepressants and 6 other medications for her other health problems. Then, thanks to a very strict elimination diet, which allowed basically only meat and select greens, virtually all her problems cleared up. Her arthritis and skin conditions cleared up in 3 weeks. Her depression disappeared in 3 months. A month after that, the extreme fatigue went away. Grains, dairy, sugar, and soy are what she's particularly wary of, but things as seemingly healthy or at least harmless as almonds, rice, white cabbage, bananas, citrus, onions, and zucchini have all given her major issues when she's tried to reintroduce them into her diet. For the past 6 months, she's been on a diet that is basically just meat, salt, and water. This was the last step in diet improvement for her. She says on her blog that on the all-meat diet, she just feels better and better. Her brain is the fastest it's ever been, and she's happy and energized all day. And now, she takes no medications at all. Rich Roll and Michaela Peterson's diets do have some similarities. They've both cut dairy, sugar, gluten, and processed foods, but the two diets are clearly very different. And while both of these people would surely say that these diets change their lives, they probably couldn't imagine themselves on each other's diets. Different diets, but different contexts. Going back to antidepressants again, we'd want to know the context in which you introduce this medication. A genetic test, for example, would be very helpful, but before you introduce a drug that increases serotonin signaling, we would at least want to verify that the person actually has low serotonin levels. Especially because antidepressants are well known to have a very high risk for complications, including the potentially life-threatening serotonin syndrome, and a black box warning for suicidal thoughts and behaviors. But, as researchers at McMaster University explain, it is currently impossible to measure exactly how the living brain is releasing and using serotonin. However, there is a kind of workaround for this. After serotonin is pumped into the synapse, it is either taken up into the presynaptic neuron for later use, or it is metabolized by an enzyme into 5-hydroxyindole acetic acid, 5-HIAA. Researchers can comb the cerebrospinal fluid for this metabolite for an indirect measurement of serotonin. So, we should expect that people with depression would have low levels of 5-HIAA, meaning they have low serotonin. But how well does this pan out? In 1971, investigators at McGill University failed to find a statistically significant difference between the 5-HIAA levels of depressed patients and normal controls, and there was no correlation whatsoever between depression severity and levels of 5-HIAA. Then in 1974, two researchers at the University of Pennsylvania found that a serotonin-depleting drug didn't reliably induce depression at all. Then, in 1975, investigators at the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm found that 30% of the depressed patients they tested indeed suffered from low levels of the serotonin metabolite 5-HIAA. But they also found that 25% of the normal group also had low cerebrospinal levels of these metabolites. Finally, in 1984, NIMH investigators wanted to see whether those depressed patients with low serotonin would be the best responders to an antidepressant. Unfortunately for the chemical imbalance theory, lead investigator James Moss wrote, "Contrary to expectations, no relationship between cerebrospinal 5-HIAA and response to the antidepressant amitriptyline were found." Simply put, researchers assumed that antidepressants were working their magic in a certain context based on what the antidepressant does, not based on proper evidence for that context. The next thing you'll want to investigate is the mechanisms behind whatever food, diet, or medication is in question. This can be a difficult step depending on your understanding of biochemistry or pharmacology, but that doesn't mean that the concepts are out of your reach. For example, let's say you hear that margarine is bad for heart health, whereas good quality butter is actually good for heart health. For some, this may sound dubious, as it's the opposite of what we've been told in the past. You can even find the Mayo Clinic website saying, "Margarine usually tops butter when it comes to heart health," as recent as last month. But then, you learn that the vitamin K2 in butter promotes the decalcification of soft tissues like the heart because decalcification is a vitamin K2-dependent process. And the hydrogenated vegetable oil in margarine inhibits these vitamin K2 processes, making it easier for soft tissues, like the heart, to calcify.
I can't believe it's not butter!
We now even have mechanisms for how the cholesterol-lowering, so-called heart-saving, statin drugs actually worsen the calcification of the heart. Statins block a crucial step in this decalcification process. Now that you have a mechanism in mind, you can investigate further. If you look up statin-induced arterial calcification, you'll find papers showing that yes, high-dose or long-term statin therapy advances arterial calcification. Going back to the antidepressants, this is one of the problems. The mechanisms for how they work is not known. For example, with the common selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, SSRI, type antidepressants, we of course know that they inhibit the reuptake of serotonin. But it's not known why that would have a therapeutic effect. Have a listen to psychiatrist Daniel Carlett's comment on this.
But on the other hand, what we don't know is we don't know how the medications actually work in the brain. When patients ask me about these medications, I'll often say something like, well, the way Zoloft works is it increases the levels of serotonin in your brain, and presumably the reason you're depressed or anxious is that you have some sort of a deficiency. I say that because patients certainly don't want to hear that a psychiatrist essentially has no idea how these medications work.
So with antidepressants, we don't actually know why they would work, and there's doubt about whether they actually do work.
Today, British researchers said several popular antidepressants are essentially no better than a placebo.
However, some people have experienced antidepressants as being truly helpful and life-saving, making the topic of their efficacy complex and out of the scope of this video. The last point is the short-term versus the long-term. This is very tricky to consider when it comes to nutrition for many reasons, one being that the body is constantly adapting and responding to what you put into it. For example, many people have had weight loss success on caloric restriction diets, but some will find later that it's difficult to maintain the lost weight thanks to an adaptation called metabolic adaptation. This is where the body drastically reduces its resting calorie burn and makes you hungrier in general from the hormonal adaptations in response to the calorie cutting. This leads us to maybe the most concerning point about antidepressants. Most of the more recent data on depression today turns out to be data on medicated depression. It's widely thought that depression is a long-term, chronic disease, and patients are often informed that they'll have to take antidepressants for life to keep their chemical imbalance corrected, sort of like a diabetic who needs to take insulin long-term. Then, it's very common for people to have a depressive relapse when going off the drugs, which is thought to be evidence for the necessity of the drugs. But what happens in people who just don't take the medication? In Robert Whitaker's book, Anatomy of an Epidemic, he explains that before the age of antidepressants, people's depression would usually resolve by itself eventually. A 1931 long-term study of 2,700 depressed patients reported that more than half of those admitted for depression only had one depressive episode and no relapse. A Swedish physician, Gunnar Lundquist, followed 216 depressed patients for 18 years and found that 49% never experienced a second depressive episode, and 76% became socially healthy and could resume their usual work. Bulgarian psychiatrist Nikola Shipkowensky said that tricyclic antidepressants were inducing the disease to change to a more chronic course. Then, in 1995, an NIMH study looked at people diagnosed with major depression who received antidepressant treatment and those who did not. At the end of 6 years, the people who received the medication were more than three times as likely to have stopped functioning in their usual societal roles. Finally, in 2006, Robert Posternak led a study that looked at people who had a depressive episode who, after recovering from the first bout of depression with medication, went on to relapse but did not go on to use medication. It was found that 23% of these unmedicated people recovered in 1 month, 67% of them recovered in 6 months, and 85% recovered within a year. So, while antidepressants might be speeding up the recovery for some depressed people in the short term, thanks to the medication, the depression becomes a long-term disease. History, context, mechanisms, and the short-term versus the long-term. 4 points for investigation that, by themselves, won't necessarily allow you to say case closed, but it will help you more efficiently process incoming health or diet information and make better conclusions. While the ability to gather heaps of knowledge was a valuable skill in the past, what is valuable nowadays is the ability to rapidly assess the merit of incoming information and ignore what is not useful. This is where this video's sponsor Dashlane comes in. There are so many things that are always fighting for our attention, and one thing you don't want to have to waste mental resources on is remembering passwords. The problem with passwords is that the more complicated they are, the safer they are, but the harder they are to remember. Thanks to Dashlane, you don't have to worry about this trade-off. Dashlane can generate, backup, and fill in your passwords for you across all your devices, keeping you extra secure with no extra mental effort necessary. And if Dashlane finds that one of your accounts is compromised, it sends a notification so you can change your password. For many websites, Dashlane can even do this for you with a single click of a button. This is the kind of protection I wish I had had earlier myself. It's really not fun finding out your account is compromised during a vacation and having to stop everything and duck into a coffee shop for several minutes and dig through the process of changing your password. Why not make securing your accounts much easier and get 10% off a premium subscription to Dashlane by clicking the link below and using the coupon code WHATIVELEARNED. The great thing about the premium subscription is it syncs your passwords between all of your devices automatically, keeping your private data up to date on your phone and computers.